We've been considering the elegant mechanism for regulating the transcription of the lac operon in the presence of lactose and the turning off of transcription of the operon in the absence of lactose. This is a great example of catabolic operon gene regulation. Now we're going to introduce one more element, one more regulatory element of the lac operon. And to do that, let's introduce another DNA, another protein binding site, the CAP binding site, which lies between the LACI repressor gene and the rest of the operon, promoter, operator, and structural genes of the operon. So the CAP binding site binds a protein called catabolite activated protein, and that's why it's called the CAP binding site. And that is part of the entire regulatory region of the LAC operon. But before we discuss the role of CAP protein binding in regulating transcription of the lactose operon, let's consider another an energetic feature that has some influence on whether the cell chooses to use lactose as an energy source or not. So let's talk about the glucose. Now, as you know, glucose can enter the glycolytic pathway directly. And therefore, the cell does not have to invest any energy in converting glucose to a sugar that can enter glycolysis and be broken down to yield energy in ATP. Whereas other sugars, like lactose and other sugars, must be converted to glucose or must produce glucose in order so that that glucose can enter the glycolytic pathway. So the cell needs to invest energy in breaking down other sugars other than glucose. So in this sense, glucose is an ideal energy source. And although other sugars are good carbohydrates and will yield energy for the cell, glucose is really the filet mignon of food with respect to bacteria. And so we need to ask ourselves, in the presence of glucose, what happens to lactose utilization by the cell? And we will find that glucose, the presence of glucose, if glucose is present at significant concentrations in the cell, glucose will inhibit the use of other sugars as energy sources. And operons that are involved in the breakdown of other sugars, other catabolic operons, in other words, will not turn on even if those other sugars are present in the presence of glucose. Glucose will lower the levels of transcription of catabolic operons. And also, glucose will inhibit the use of other sugars. So it inhibits the use of other sugars, one, by lowering transcription of catabolic operons. And two, it will prevent the uptake up by the cell of other sugars. So lactose, for example, is an inducer of the lactose operon. Well, and when glucose is present at high enough levels in the cell, glucose will block the uptake of lactose. This is called inducer exclusion. So glucose will prevent the uptake of other sugars and thereby prevent the activation by inducers of catabolic operons. But also, the presence of glucose will lower the transcription of catabolic operons. And for the lactose operon, let's look at that in a little bit of detail here. And before we do that, let's consider now, we're going to consider how transcription of the lactose operon is lowered in the presence of glucose, even if lactose is around. We need to consider the relationship between glucose, the concentration of glucose in the cell, and the concentration of a molecule, cyclic AMP, which we've come across in eukaryotic cells as a potent second messenger. Well, there is an inverse relationship between the concentration of glucose in the cell and the concentration of cyclic AMP. When glucose levels are very low, there is a high concentration of cyclic AMP. Whereas when glucose levels are very high, there is a low level of cyclic AMP in the cell. And cyclic AMP, as we are going to see, is going to be an allosteric regulator of a protein that we've mentioned, the CAP protein, or the catabolite activated protein. CAP, C-A-P. So let's look at now how it is that cyclic AMP, remembering the cyclic AMP levels are high when glucose is low, but very low when glucose levels are high, let's see how cyclic AMP regulates the lactose operon. And in that way, we can understand how the presence of glucose can lower the transcription of catabolic operons like the lactose operon. So let's take that up next. So here is our standard model of the lac operon, but with the following additional regulatory step introduced. Here we have repression of the operon due to lactose being absent, and the lac repressor is bound to the operator, and transcription of the operon by RNA polymerase cannot occur. But what about the role of CAP here? The CAP protein is rendered into a conformation that has high affinity for the CAP binding site when cyclic AMP is bound at an allosteric binding site on CAP. And CAP protein interacts with RNA polymerase and helps load it, helps activate the promoter by interacting with RNA polymerase and loading RNA polymerase, readying RNA polymerase to transcribe the operon if the repressor falls off operator DNA. So let's look at the case now where the operon is induced when the repressor falls off operator DNA. We have CAP bound to the CAP binding site here, having loaded RNA polymerase at the promoter, and the operon will then be transcribed in the presence of lactose so that the cell can break down lactose. Fine. But if glucose is present, CAP, the cyclic AMP levels are low, and therefore CAP, the allosteric binding site that binds cyclic AMP on CAP is not bound. Cyclic AMP is not bound to CAP, and CAP does not bind to its binding site. And therefore, the activation of the promoter actually is not as efficient. And so transcription of the operon will be lowered even if lactose is present and the repressor comes off of DNA. But furthermore, because glucose can block the uptake of other sugars like lactose through a mechanism that we call inducer exclusion, then the presence of glucose will lower the concentration of lactose in the cell, even if the concentration of lactose outside the cell is relatively high. So inducer exclusion by glucose itself will then lower intracellular lactose concentrations and endow the repressor then with high affinity for operator DNA blocking transcription of the operon. But furthermore, the second effect now of glucose is that the cyclic AMP levels are low and the CAP protein therefore will not be in a conformation that allows it to have high affinity for the CAP binding site. And that does not activate the promoter as much as it normally would. So what we have here then is the ability of bacterial cells to lower the expression of catabolic operons when glucose, the ideal energy source, is available to them. And this is an additional level of regulation of catabolic operons. To sum up then and reiterate, let's look at when glucose is low in the cell, cyclic AMP levels are high. CAP will be bound at the CAP binding site because of its bound cyclic AMP. That will activate the promoter. if lactose is around, then lactose will regulate the change the conformation of the repressor molecule, so it will not be bound to operator DNA, and transcription of the operon will occur, and we have a situation in which lactose will then be utilized by the cell. Now it's time to move on to anabolic operons, and let's take as our example the tryptophan operon, which produces an amino acid, tryptophan, used in protein synthesis and as a precursor to other compounds in the cell. So we're looking at the biosynthesis now of tryptophan. Anabolic pathways are biochemical pathways that are biosynthetic pathways in which a substance is built up from precursor compounds through a series of biochemical steps catalyzed by individual enzymes, as opposed to catabolic operons, which are involved in producing gene products, enzymes that degrade foodstuffs for energy. So here we have the production of tryptophan, and the biochemical steps, steps of this pathway leading to the synthesis of tryptophan are catalyzed by a series of enzymes encoded by genes of the TRP operon, the tryptophan operon. So we have the TRPD gene, the TRPE gene, the TRPC gene, and the TRPA gene and B gene, all of which encode proteins and enzymes that are involved in the biosynthesis, the anabolism, in other words, of tryptophan, the amino acid tryptophan. So let's think about this energetically for a moment and think about it from a designer's point of view. When would we want the tryptophan operon to be on? When tryptophan levels in the cell are high or when they are low? And if you think about that for a few moments, you will immediately come to the conclusion that if the product of this biosynthetic anabolic pathway is at high levels in the cell, then it would behoove the cell to turn off the operon that is generating the enzymes responsible for making more of the product, tryptophan in this case. Whereas if tryptophan is at low levels in the cell, if the product of this biosynthetic pathway is at low levels, then we would want to synthesize more of that product, and therefore we would want to express the genes that encode the enzymes responsible for the biosynthesis of this product, of this amino acid in this case. So let's look at, keeping that energetic consideration in mind, let's look at the regulation of the tryptophan operon. Like the lactose operon, the tryptophan operon is negatively regulated by a repressor protein. But that repressor protein in this case, like the lac operon, has allosteric binding sites for ligand, but that ligand is the amino acid tryptophan itself in this case. And unlike the lactose molecule, which renders the repressor of the lactose operon incapable of binding operator DNA, tryptophan, the product of the biosynthetic pathway that we're considering, is a co-repressor. It binds to allosteric binding sites on the repressor protein, the TRP repressor protein, promoting its association with operator DNA by rendering it in a conformation that has high affinity for the nucleotide sequence at the operator, and causing the operon to be turned off by virtue of having repressor bound to operator, preventing the promoter that has bound RNA polymerase preventing RNA polymerase that is bound to the promoter, I should say, from transcribing the operon. So here, the end product of the operon shuts of the pathway that the operon gene products run. That end product acts as a negative regulator of the operon by acting as a co-repressor for the repressor protein that shuts the operon off, which, as we've said, makes perfect sense. Lots of tryptophan around shut down the operon. Not very much tryptophan around turn on the operon. And the operon would be turned on under low tryptophan conditions because there would not be bound tryptophan on the tryptophan repressor, and that repressor would fall off the operator DNA. We'll pick up with regulation of the TRP operon in a little more detail in the next part of this lecture.